I wasn't sure if we start at 9:30 or 9:35, but we can do a little get to know you real quick and let people add in. So welcome to Stagecraft, where we're going to take a look at how you tell the audience what to expect when you stand up on stage. The first thing I want to do, though, is welcome everybody here and just get a quick note from everybody. So go ahead and unmute yourselves, and we can all say your name, and you can tell me who you are and where you're from and what you do for the chorus. So let's start with Linda.
Okay, I'm on the visual team for Helen Express Singers, and I typically do the w physical warm-ups and some of the teaching of choreography.
Great, great. And Charlene, hello, Charlene.
Hi, Katy. Hi, everyone. My name is Charlene O'Connor, and I'm the director of Voices Northwest Chorus, and I'm always eager to learn, so that's why I'm here.
Thank you for coming. And Jocelyn?
I'm Jocelyn Riley. I'm the visual communications leader for Alaska Television.
Wonderful, wonderful. Both of the two of you and Christy have just had a fun time in Louisville with your choruses on stage. So that's really congratulations on your success there. Maureen.
Hi, I'm Maureen Davis with the Coeur d'Alene Chorus, and I'm kind of a newbie and wanting to learn as much as I can about the visual communications. So that's why I'm here.
Great. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And
Thank
you
you.
were a good sport, yes, last night when we did a few exercises. Margaret?
Hi, I'm Margaret Eby. I'm the director of Olympia Chorus, and I have like zero experience with visual expression, so I'm here to soak it all up.
Awesome. Awesome. And Christy.
I'm Christy Hedrick with Alaska Sound Celebration. I'm on the visual communications team with Jossie. She's our fearless leader. She's amazing at it too, by the way. Anybody, if she ever moves, snag her up. And I'm also your recorder, so they needed someone to come record some of the sessions. So I'm like, okay, I'll do visual communication only.
Thank you so much, Christy, because I know we're holding you captive because you have a job to do. So I
You're good.
appreciate
No,
the
it's great information. Last night was
that.
wonderful. So great, great
Good.
information.
Great. And then Sarah.
Hi. I know I look a little rough this morning, but I'm glad to be here.
You're here. It's okay. It's
It's Saturday,
oof.
no judgment.
So it's nice to meet everybody. I'm really new to Sweet Adelines and just proud to be here to, on Katie's team and just like soaking it in and helping in any way that I can. So anyway, excited to listen in.
Awesome. And Ruth Ann. Hi, Ruth Ann. Maybe she's not here yet. There she
I am. Hi, Katy. Ruth Ann Browse. I sing and I'm on visual team with Voices Northwest and just trying to learn more and keep up with Charlene. So
Yes, exactly. Well, awesome. Thank you all for doing that and introducing yourselves. I think that's everybody. So we'll move back into a quick little review of what we did last night. And my notes are over here. Hang on. And into our Stagecraft. Okay. Yesterday, we talked about studying the visual communication category through the judging category description booklet that can be found on the Sweet Adelines website. There is a visual communication chapter because it is one of four categories. And then all the elements that show up on the score sheet are also beautifully described in that chapter. And the words they use are really descriptive and lovely. So it's a nice read. And a nice thing to study. We looked at combining your mindset with your knowledge. Both, they've got to go hand in hand. You've got to own and love who you are in the moment, in the phase that you're in and you're learning, along with the knowledge that you're going to take in so that they sink into each other. It works way better if you've got the mindset of, I want to get better, and then the knowledge swirls into that. All right, it mixes. It's like oil and vinegar when it just sits there versus when you shake it up with a whisk or something really hard, right? And then we found activities for little breakouts for 5 to 10 minutes in chorus rehearsal to give people a little brain break and to give people a little physical, maybe reoxygenation, because they're a little bit fun and silly and, you know, trying things out for the first time. So that was, I think that was well received last night. And then we emphasize authenticity by having your own perspective on the emotion that's being requested from your visual communications person. Everybody doesn't have to come from the same story when you say, please feel reminiscent about this moment. It's not happening now. It's something that sort of you're recalling in a nice reminiscent way. That's all you have to say. Then they put themselves in the setting they want, the visual setting, what it smells like around them, who's with them, and what the actual occasion is that they're feeling reminiscent. Because you can infuse authentic emotions into barbershop song words. You know, that's why we're artists, right? We can put an emotion from a real place in our hearts into a story about somebody else. So you don't have to always be singing about yourself. You need to be singing for the connection of the audience and for a character that's going through something in the song you're singing. And oftentimes when a friend tells you, you know, I lost my cat. And that cat has been with me for 20 years. And maybe you're not a cat person. What do you do? Do you say, well, I'm not a cat person, so sorry, I don't. Of course you understand the loss, because maybe you had a dog. Maybe you had a relative that was just as important and comforting as the cat was for that person. So do you see what I'm saying there? Is you can take your own personal experience into an emotion that speaks a different story because the song has different words. So does that make sense? Nods, shakes, good. Okay. And we talked about maybe trying to keep a personal journal as a chorus member about the songs, and that visual communication leaders can write out the lyrics to a song and in the margins throw in what those emotional thoughts should be, like reminiscence, you know, or pride, or all kinds of different feelings and thoughts, right? And then your chorus members can rewrite notations and lyrics and things that get them to that space. So that's our recap of yesterday. Now we're going to go into Stagecraft, which is actually really fun. I love Stagecraft because I'm always asking myself when I watch performance, what do they want me to feel? What do they want me to understand? What are they trying to tell me? And usually it's before they even sing, right? So I'm going to share some slides with you and we'll go through our Stagecraft. Let's see, I got to hit share screen and then I'm going to hit Stagecraft. If I don't, my daughter says I verbally process. I think I believe her. Okay. You can all see something that says Stagecraft, right? The effective management of theatrical devices or techniques. That's just a good old definition of, you know, what it is. First, you have to start with a blank space. Starting blank means to take away all your assumptions, all preconceptions, judgments, and fears. You have to start not from just the ground up or the beginning of the story. You need to start from beneath the ground or what happened before the story. Ask, why are we here? What are we doing here? There's a quote from Helen Mirren that says, theater is an empty space that we fill with our imagination, our poetry, our technique, our passion, and our insecurity. It's up to us to fill that empty space with ourselves and the story we're going to tell. It comes from within, and the stage is just an expression of how we're going to tell that story. So you have the visual, and you have an immediate attitude that you need to try to exude in every member of your chorus. Now, the elements of stagecraft, every time we set a stage, we create a world that our audience is going to experience, hopefully instantaneously, at least in the first impression. The elements of stagecraft consist of those devices and those techniques that will tell your audience exactly where they are and what they're supposed to feel. I'm going to use some pictures here to kind of show you what I'm talking about. So here's some emotion. This is the opening of Lion King. And you see the dark blue. You see one person standing there in a dark setting. So it's either the end of the day or the beginning of a day. But it's immediately draws you into the feeling that blue exudes, right? There's a producer, a master set designer, who has designed sets for Hamilton, Dear Evan Hansen, Bruno Mars, Lady Gaga, all kinds of really, really big hit type shows. And his name is David Korins, K-O-R-I-N-S. If you ever want to look up anything he talks about or YouTubes about or writes about, he says that emotion becomes light and color. So when you paint with light and color, you're painting feelings. And that answers the question. You give your audience a color. You give them, you know, we don't get to give them lighting when we're on a contest stage, but we can give them lighting through our faces. We can tell them that really the lights shining down right now should be red because I'm evil or angry, or they should be yellow and sunny because look at my face, right? Your face can set the lighting we don't have when we're in contest mode. Time and place. Again, Lion King. This is the rising of the sun. And it conveys where and when we are taking our audience. It also, the music comes up and conveys the time and place as the African drums start to drum and the humming and chanting that goes on. You know immediately, if you've never even heard about Lion King, that you're going to experience something in that time and that place. And we have character. The audience wants to know, okay, who's going to be telling this story? Where will I put my attention? And again, you can boil this kind of thing down into a two-song contest set. You just have to be a little more creative with how you get, you know, the African savanna into your mindset, right? If you're going to sing a real African drumming, humming, chanting kind of song in this case. Maybe your costumes would help with character. And then the storyline. Here you can see, if you're just looking at it and you're not hearing anything going on, you see, okay, there's somebody up high that's elevated. That's the focal point. And then there are a mixture, animals and people below. And some of them seem to be bowing down. And you can see the people's headdresses in the background bowing down. So you've set up a quick picture of who's important and what's going on here. We all revere whatever and whoever is standing on top of that elevated surface. So that is just how they do it for this particular story. But you can also set up your staging to also create a picture moment of what you're going to be doing. Even if you're just in a contest song, you can still be visually appropriate to the story. Now, Lion King is, you know, 2.5 hours, right? And this opening number is 4.5 minutes of that 2.5 hours. That's 3% of the entire run of the show to set your emotion, time and place, character and story. So when you think of us, we have maybe a 6 or 7 minute set of songs, and do the math. You know, we have 3 to 4 seconds. If we take 3% of 6 or 7 minutes, that's not very much, right? So we have to hit everything all at the same time in what we do. We can't take time to build, whether you're doing an entertainment package that's 15 minutes long or a 2-song set for contest. You've got that blink of an eye and that first intake of the entire picture. And I just want to make sure that, you know, you value how important all the setup is. So as a recap, the emotion comes through the colors, the lighting, the sizes and shapes of things, the music, and time and place, costuming, sets if you're doing an entertainment package, character, costuming, body characterization, huge to understand who you should be and what your body should be doing. And then setting the stage. Again, if you're doing something a little bit more long, lighting, stage placement, things like that. But you can do staging for your contest song that is going to also set the stage, right? We've all seen big, wide, proud, bold setups, and the some people sitting on the ground and some people leaning on each other. Those two things tell our audience two different things, and it's very, very helpful to understand that as a performer. Now, I want us to take a little time here to study. And we do have the time to do it. I want us to watch 2 semi-performances. So that would be, and let me stop share for just a second. What we've just talked about, it takes a second to sink in, right? You got colors and emotion and characterization and body, but let's look at how a clump of people who want to perform put themselves together in order to put you in a place and in order for you to understand what they're trying to convey through their songs, what how they want you to feel. Because again, it's we worry so much about ourselves, but it's really about how the audience is going to feel. Because last night we went through those grade sheets, those level descriptors that are also in the judging category description book. And they show high level audience connection is part of a higher, a B and an A performance. When you're in a C performance, you're not attaining audience connection. At low C, you're not even trying, according to the level descriptor. But at high C, you're starting to show some intention for it. You're just not hitting it, right? So audience, that's mindset. It's about the audience. It's about the story and feeling the audience is going to get. So as we look at these 2 performances, we can share the screen again. This was from international competition, just in Louisville. And I picked Lionsgate who won, but they were first in visual communication, the first in the, during the semifinals. And then they went on to win the contest. That doesn't mean that they won every category straight across the board. But we're looking at the visual communication. So we're going to look at their semifinals set. And then vocal standard is a smaller chorus than Lionsgate. They also used different costumes and had no real defined choreo. So you're going to see two, and they came in sixth in visual communications after the semifinals. In the finals, they ended up in 10th. But so effective doing two different kinds of presentations. One big chorus, same costumes, lots of similar moves, and then the other, different costumes, no real defined choreo. So if we can have you take notes on what you see, I want you to look and think about a couple of different things. I have it written down. That's not where I have it written down. So when you watch these, watch for the stance, the energy, watch the lower body, because that's where you get a lot of your authenticity and freedom. Because if your lower body is strong, your upper body can be much more fluid. And if you're stick straight, then you have to do everything with your arms. And your arms create bad tension for your voice, right? So you want a strong lower body and a much more fluid upper body. And it also, that alignment thing we were doing with our bobbleheads creates less space for your face to get all tense. You know, I really mean it. And, you know, all those kinds of tension-filled spaces. If you stay in your bubble space, what comes from your heart can come right up out through your eyes and your face. It's, I don't know why. I don't have the scientific reason for it. So look at that. And then also look at the varying ages of the people and imagine the stories, their backstories, and how they differ. Because they stand right next to all different kinds of women, right? We stand next to all sorts of different people when we're singing in our choruses. And what is so inspiring to me is that we carry the same care and emotion for the story. No matter who we are and how different we are from the person next to us. So note that too. So we're going to take the 6 or 7 minutes per to just watch and let you take some notes and study with the filter of what you've heard so far. And, you know, some of the, what's the word, concepts or elements that we study in this visual communication category. So we'll go back and I'll play Lionsgate. Why is Lionsgate not on here? Hold, please. There's some audience connection.
Why?
You think? So go ahead and everybody unmute and we'll have a little conversation. And if you have something to say, just kind of do this. But is there one word that you think of when you see their visual presentation or make their audience connection? Carrie.
Energy.
Energy. Christy.
Authentic.
Authentic. Yeah.
Captivating. Any other words?
Captivating from Sarah. Yeah. I saw fluidity between emotions. I was so impressed. I mean, that's kind of, I think, what gets me teary-eyed a little bit when I watch it and inspired, mm-hmm. because they flow from one to the other. And that is a lot of training.
Yeah.
That's a lot of practice and then letting the muscle memory take over so that they can stay in their hearts. You saw a lot of lack of tension, right?
Mm-hmm.
What about the different types of people? Any impressions on when you looked at two people standing next to each other who were completely different ages or looks?
Yeah, it didn't feel like anybody, they were trying to be like exactly the same. It's like they were doing similar or same things, but they didn't have to look exactly like each other. It all worked, showing the movement they were working or doing, but it was all done within themselves, if that makes any sense at all. It was like, and then all just sort of contributes to the whole picture.
Right. It bubbled up from the story, mm-hmm. in their heart, right? And then certain words, you could really see people meaning that word, and everybody's heads were a little different, but they all, mm-hmm. equally meant it, right? Now, they all had the same choreography. They all had, right. the same outfit on. And I think that's helpful when you have a very large chorus. I think you have to be much more careful if you're going to wear a huge variety of stuff in a really big picture like that, because then you're busy sorting as an audience member, counting the dark and light and, you know, all that stuff. So you do get away with a little bit more of variety of costuming if you're a little smaller group. But it's a lot more work. I mean, North Metro Chorus, if you ever want to look up them from years gone by, or even currently, you know, they've had much varying costumes, but still in the same sort of palette, right? So as far as studying their moves, this is important because oftentimes we tend to go, I want to be like them. Man, they're good. Why? Let's just copy them. Well, you can't. You can't copy somebody else and be authentic. Sorry, I'm shaking my hands. But you really do have to come up with it from your own chorus persona.
Personality, true.
Yeah, and your own chorus personality. Yeah. So are there any body parts that you noticed and what was happening with them? Christy.
I was waiting. I'm like, I noticed this because you mentioned it early on, even when we were doing physical warm-ups, about having that bent knee and using the lower half of your body. And you could see on the risers, like all of them had that same stance, and the upper part of their body was just so loose and free.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They're a perfect example of starting with the lower body. Last night I said that there was a set for my chorus that I didn't do any upper body choreo at all until they really had their lower body loosened up. And it really freaked some people out because they want to know. They want to know what it is they need to do, right? What am I going to end up doing? Well, what you're going to end up doing is you're going to end up sharing a story from your heart. So what these things do is much less important until it comes from your heart. So you got to work the power and the energy of the lower body and the heart. And then you get to move your arms and change your position on stage.
Yeah, and that's what brings it back to the warm-ups, the physical warm-ups feels like. Mm-hmm. Because you can get some of that muscle memory going inside those.
Yeah, exactly. Physical warm-ups should always present some muscle memory opportunities. Charlene?
Yeah, you're talking about the legs and the thighs and how that has to be firm. I've always talked about using that, the word I always use is a foundation. It's like if you're building a house, if the foundation isn't strong, which is your legs and your thighs, you can't sing from the heart. You can't give from the heart. And I think what you're saying, Katy, is that letting the chorus know the importance of that foundation. And once you get over that, then you can explode into wonderful, wonderful things. So I'm glad that you're stressing the foundation of the legs so much. Thank you.
You're welcome. And Maureen?
I was really struck by the use of their lower body as the members of the front line would sit on the floor, still be able to produce the power to sing and have that energy. But they were up and down, what, two or three times? I mean, completely on the floor, different stages. And that was truly amazing to me. It was just fluid and it looked effortless, although of course we know it wasn't. But again, that's that lower body foundation is so extremely important.
Mm-hmm. Jocelyn?
Yeah, I did notice they use the floor a lot. And then also the rhythm in their bodies, even during the ballad, like, the whole chorus mm-hmm. was like feeling the rhythm. And I mean, there was a little bit of a rhythmic section, but it was really powerful. Not something that we see normally.
Right. That's a lot of work, you know, and it takes years to get you there. Linda?
Well, I was thinking that there were a lot of emotion expressed in their faces as well, that it is kind of hard to do a lot of times, and they really did do a good job of that.
Yeah, no mm-hmm. one really stuck out because they weren't. And I think that's what sometimes you see is the people who aren't, really kind of, for some reason, it's jarring. But in amazing, in a group of that size, you really didn't see anyone that was just standing there, you know.
Right. And that's focus on story and your own. If you want to build that in your chorus, then you focus on the personal story behind the emotion you want to convey. Everybody has a personal story, and what they go home and visualize is their underlayment of their emotions and experiences to the story, right? It's like the fluff under the big poofy skirt, right? So I'll give you my comments and then we'll go to the next one. If their opener on Cabaret was, you immediately said, this is going to be joyful, right? Their hands ended up, people were standing on thighs of other people, and it was very like, oh, okay. And then what did they do? They went into, what good is sitting? They went very quiet. What if they hadn't done the joyful intro and they just started with, what good is sitting? You would go, okay, this is their ballad. It's going to be very calm and introspective. They didn't want you to feel that, did they? So they told you what to feel. And then they took you on a ride. They said, we're going to be joyful.
They hooked you in.
They hooked you in. And so while you were left with your joyful, wow, then you got to watch the pensive, introspective, what good is sitting alone in a room? And so effective to make that choice. Just so effective. And then between songs, they took time to reset. You know, there were like three good breaths that they could take to really, well, get their breath back, but also to reset their attitude. Value that. Make a note of that as a visual communication leader, that it's okay to set that and to have a little story in the chorus's head of what's happening between songs so that they all still stay in character and they all still stay authentic. And then I love the take every risk, and they're pounding their feet on the ground, you know, and making that boom, boom when it is appropriate in the song. So those were my high points. Now let me get you to the other one. And let me make sure I have an open tab. So hold, please. Let's see. How do I do that? Okay. Now I can share my screen. Because it's right there. Go.
In five. From Kansas City, Missouri, under the direction of Rob Mance, Vocal Standard Chorus!
Bye. one thing I'll say. Here's the one and only thing I'll say. I found a new baby, da da da. I found a new toy, da da da. That sweet talking baby is gonna be my joy. It's gonna be my joy. His new way of loving is all that I crave. The sweet turtle dove. So awfully nice to be on solid ground. They are charming, I confess, more than you, but I digress. Tell me, darling, can you guess what I found? Just what I found. Baby, I found a new baby. I just found a new toy. That's me talking, baby. Oh boy, it fills me with joy. This brand new way of loving is everything that I might crave.
Sorry. Here we are. The pressure's on. We have 3 minutes.
This is visually stunning, I think.
Thoughts?
That's
thoughts about the different people, the different backstories. Sally, unmute and then talk.
Yes, you could see it on their faces. You could see it in their physical movements that weren't exactly the same, and yet it all fit. I just loved it. It was just fabulous. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was
the same story coming from each one because their personalities showed and they were different. But it was okay. They were sharing their feelings from their heart, that you could see that.
Yeah. And all their heads were very, very relaxed. Mm-hmm. That Rob Mancy is the posture king. So I would expect his chorus to have great posture and good head alignment. But you can ask your chorus members to do that. You really can. You don't think that that's unattainable because all they're doing is standing with a good, strong, fluid, supported foundational stance. And then believing in what they're singing from their perspective. That's it. That's all. There's nothing more. There's no like magic thing to do with your eyebrows or thing you're supposed to do with your hand or it. And the more you can shake loose from the questions in your chorus's brain about, what am I supposed to do next? What am I supposed to do next? Well, I don't know. What do you feel like doing next? Is your foundation strong? Does that need to be reset and re-loosened up a little bit? Or, you know, it all relates to stagecraft, because the only thing you have in this sort of setting is your singers and their costumes and how they're presenting themselves. Those are the two things you have to create all the things we looked at in Lion King, right? But you can do it if you intentionally say,
yeah,
you know, we're starting out late at night and you guys put yourself in a great place, and these are the emotions we want to start with, you know.
The other thing that the picture said was they all have confidence in how they are appearing, how they are sounding. I mean, they're, you know, that's just apparent when you watch that they're feeling super comfortable with what they're doing.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So you can teach that if you're intentional about teaching it. If you write down your goals before each rehearsal or say them to yourself in the car on the way there, I am going to get my chorus more connected through this mechanism. And then you choose the mechanism you're going to use that night and you're going to work on it. And if you ever need help with mechanisms, watch Charlene's visual communication presentation that the region asked her to do. It's really a great masterclass. And if you need help finding it, we'll help you find it, because there's lots of tools in there. So thank you for this. Thank you for your participation. We'll see you.